Cleanse thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God's whole creation groans. The land produces thorns and thistles and longs to be set free. Our sin affects all around us. We confess ourselves in penitence and faith.
Creator God, we confess that we have not honoured and obeyed you. We have broken our relationships with one another, abused your fragile creation, wounded your love, and marred your holy natures. We are sorry and repent of all our sins. Father, forgive us. Lead us from apathy to love. Strengthen us as stewards of your precious people and of your glorious creation. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Amen.
Give you the joy of his kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We stand to say the Lord.
Glory to God in highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heaven and King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
God, who in generous mercy sent the Holy Spirit upon your church in the burning fire of your love,
Grant that your people may be fervent in the fellowship of the gospel, that always abiding in you, they may be found steadfast in faith and active in service. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Sit for the first reading.
The reading is taken from the book of Jonah. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is this not what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "It is right for you to be angry." Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah, so that he was faint, and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor, and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night, and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the labourers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the labourers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose, what belongs to me, with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Very conscious that having welcomed the choir back, I'm now going to talk with my back to them through this. Just the unfortunate logistics of this layout, so I hope you can still hear and listen. For me, one of the most spirit-sapping, soul-crushing dimensions of the present environmental crisis is its unfairness. Why should children today grow up never having the chance to see a coral reef or a white rhino? Or even in this country, something as traditional as a cuckoo, now nearly all gone. More seriously, why should millions of children grow up never, at least until lockdown, breathing clean air? And why should those with the lowest carbon emissions suffer the most from the horrible effects of climate change? It's just not fair. And both our readings today echo with that same cry. It's not fair. We hear Jonah, who is upset that his preaching has been so successful that the Ninevites are spared, and upset that the bush that grew up quickly to grow in the shade has been withered. We hear the story of the vineyard workers hired at intervals through the day, some working all day through the heat, some only an hour, but all being paid the same. It raises that same complaint. It's not fair. The cry for fairness is perhaps one of the first complaints we learn as children, especially if we have siblings. Of course, our childish whine, "It's not fair," normally means everything isn't exactly how I would like it to be, rather than being entirely about fairness. But as we grow older, we realise that life really isn't fair. Bad things happen to good people, and vice versa. Footballers earn millions, whilst hard-working nurses scrape a pittance. People get sick and die through no fault of their own. Famines, disasters, and even pandemics occur. Life is not fair. It can be hard, seemingly cruel, and even deliberately having a laugh at our expense. But we expect God to be fair. God is, after all, described as righteous, as just. He's supposed to uphold good people and take vengeance on the wicked. Yet, even short experience with life shows us that this is not so. Matthew writes earlier in his gospel, he makes the sun rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. And it all leads to the question, what do we make of this perplexing parable? It's worth noting that all the workers are paid equally. It's not as if the first workers are not paid or are paid less than the last workers. So when Jesus says at the end, for effect, the last will be first and the first last, it's a kind of rabbinic exaggeration. It's not that the order of rewards has been reversed. It's that there's no order at all. All is based on the employer's generosity, or in the technical language of Christianity, on grace. Secondly, it's worth thinking about who we think we are in the parable. There's a natural tendency among Christians to think that we are the labourers who've not been working all day, have certainly done more than those who only showed up in the last hour. We somehow feel we are entitled, that we've earned a bit more consideration, that our efforts should be recognised and properly compensated. Religious people can tend to think that they're a bit better than those who are not in the club, and that those outside just aren't quite up to scratch. In contrast, and it's always salutary, if you read the papers or talk to those outside the church, it's clear that their perception is that people in the church are rather worse than average humanity. The media's bias towards stories of scandal and weakness in the church is certainly in part to blame for that, but there is at least a grain of truth to it. Hypocrisy and becoming like the proverbial Pharisees have always been the besetting sins of the church, and after all, the church is for sinners. The famous riposte to the allegation that the church is full of hypocrites is, yes, and there's always room for more. Although I come from the Catholic tradition, I still think it's worth repeating the central earth-shattering tenet of Reformation theology, that nothing we can do will earn our salvation. We can never be good enough for long enough to earn God's favour. But he loves us anyway. That's what grace is. Our human strength and wisdom and goodness will always be weakness and foolishness and wickedness next to God's, but he loves us anyway. That, I think, is the message of the parable. We cannot earn God's love, for we already have it. All we have to do is show willing to labour in the vineyard, no matter how feeble or how tardy our efforts. Facing the tides of injustice and intolerance, ecological destruction and human degradation in the world around us, it's reassuring to know that it being set right does not rely on our labours, but that the earth is the Lord's. Life is not fair, but God's love goes further than fairness. We stand to declare our faith, responding to the questions of the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist.
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit or kneel as we pray. Let us pray to God that he will bring to fruition all that he desires for his creation. Lord, in your mercy, you have created the universe by your eternal word. You have blessed humankind in making us stewards of the earth. We pray for your world, that we may share and conserve its resources, and live in reverence for the creation and in harmony with one another. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have given the human race a rich land, a land of streams and springs, wheat and barley, vines and oil and honey. We have made by sin a world of suffering and sorrow. We pray for those who bear the weight of affliction, that they may come to share the life of wholeness and plenty. Lord, in your mercy. In Christ you call us to a new way of life, loving our neighbours before ourselves. Help us to treat with care and respect the world as it is, as we live in hope and anticipation of the world as it will be, when your kingdom comes and your will is done. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We thank you for those, living and departed, who have shown respect for your creation. Help us to follow in their footsteps, until with them we see you face to face, when all is made new in Christ our Lord. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. We stand for the words of the peace. You shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks.
Blessed are you, Lord God, our light and our salvation.
To you be glory and praise forever. From the beginning you have created all things, and all your works echo the silent music of your praise. In the fullness of time you made us in your image, a crown of all creation. You give us breath and speech, that with angels and archangels and all the powers of heaven we may find a voice to sing your praise. Sinners, with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms on the cross. And the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave them thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking a cup of wine, he gave him thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Father, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. We remember his dying and rising in glory, and we rejoice that he intercedes for us at your right hand. Pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts of your creation. May they be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ, and build us into a living temple to your glory. Bring us at the last with all the saints to the vision of that eternal splendour for which you have created us, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in him, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessed
and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We are one body, because we need to share in one body.
Our Lord, save.
this is your tradition to do so, and you're visiting here today, you do feel welcome to do so. If you just allow the choir to come forward and receive the bread before we celebrate. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only to say the word, and the light shall be.
Thank you. this service, just to highlight a couple of notices from the water sheet. Next Sunday, the 27th, we'll be keeping our harvest Thanksgiving. Like everything else at the moment, it won't be quite what we're used to, not least because we won't be able to sing together the traditional harvest hymns. And in case you weren't aware, whilst indoor performances are allowed now, hence the return of the choir, we're still not allowed to sing hymns as a congregation. So we won't also be bringing offerings up to the altar and having all that handling and back and forth as we would normally. But we are collecting for the Leicester South Food Bank. I'm sure you're aware that lockdown has brought hardship to many, and use of food banks has escalated accordingly. So if you're able to support that, as detailed in the notice sheet, you're welcome to bring offerings along next Sunday, or if you don't want to bring goods, then money to enable them to buy the food they need is also appreciated. Slightly closer to home, you will see the next notice that Annabelle, our church administrator, is leaving at the end of this month. She's moving down to the Bristol area, so she's going the opposite direction from which I came. Again, the restrictions mean that we aren't able to have a celebration and farewell that we would want to, but of course she goes with our best wishes and prayers, and in due course, in easier times, she will come back so we can say goodbye properly, if that doesn't sound too ridiculous. We pray for God's blessing. May God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all goodness and life, pour his blessing on all things created and upon you, his children, so that you may use his gifts of his glory and the welfare of all peoples. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve them.